last Sunday, we heard of the tension and the divisions that were developing in the church in Corinth, where some were aligning themselves with one church leader, while others believed that a different leader was more their style. Some said, "I belong to Paul." Others, "I belong to Apollos." Yet others, "I belong to Cephas." And then some, "I belong to Christ." But as today's second reading continues immediately after last week's text, there is deeper conflict going on in the story, which St. Paul addresses in today's reading. The subject of human wisdom, our kind of wisdom, versus that of the wisdom of God. And Paul speaks of the conflict of wisdom and power going on in the Corinthian community, which was a part of their lives both inside and outside of the church building. They were allowing the world's ideals to dictate their lives, as well as seeing their leaders as having certain levels of knowledge. And Paul therefore speaks to them about the weakness and foolishness of God, as if those and not power and wisdom are the ways of God. And we may ask, what is Paul talking about? A weak and foolish God? But the problem which Paul was addressing was that to some people, the message about Jesus being crucified, that the Messiah was put to death, might seem ridiculous or absurd or even moronic, which is the actual meaning of the word foolish in this sense. However, God uses the message of the cross to bring salvation to those who believe. For the message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. Remember, the Hebrew people had always been looking forward to the coming of the Messiah, and they're still looking for him today. But the Jews wanted spectacular signs. They wanted miracles from heaven, so the cross was more or less a disgrace to them. And on the other hand, the Greeks wanted logical reasoning, so the cross, too, was outrageous for them. But what St. Paul was doing was contrasting the cleverness of words and speech of human beings with God's word, which reveals his wisdom. And Paul goes on to quote from Isaiah chapter 29 and verse 14, "I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart." And God works in unexpected ways. And some people might see that the gospel of Christ, the gospel of grace, is a message of weakness. But Paul says it is a message of power. A message of power. In other words, what appears powerful and wise is actually foolishness. And what appears foolish is actually what saves people and saves us. God comes to us on his own terms, not on ours. And oftentimes, we may not like his terms. Nevertheless, what appears to be God's foolishness is far above our human understanding, for God has chosen and continued to choose what is foolish and weak and low and despised in the world, so that we do not boast in our own strength or wisdom, but in God and God alone. Now let me make it clear that Paul is not objecting to the intellect or the intelligence or the advancements of technology or science or anything of that sort that exists in our own times. God has given this intelligence and skill to people. That's not what Paul is speaking about. Paul is talking about those who disbelieve, Those who refuse to follow God's word and message and the truth of salvation by faith in Christ, and instead of following or refusing to follow God's message, they follow their own beliefs about life and about philosophy and about who God is and what God is like. And this leads Paul to ask the question, where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe or the teacher of the law? And we know most of them did not accept the message of salvation. Paul asks, where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? And you and I, as human beings, we value learning. We value education. But God's message does not depend on human approval. People cannot know God through their own intellect or through their own intelligence. And they cannot save themselves by any amount of philosophy or study. Instead, God decided to save people who believe the gospel. People who need and study and live the gospel. You know, sometimes we wonder, why doesn't God reveal himself to us? Why doesn't he reveal himself to us? And we need to ask ourselves, what kind of relationship do we have with God? Because God reveals himself more and more when we decide to learn and to read about him more and more. That is how he reveals. So if God is, for whatever reason, not revealing himself to us in our lives, don't blame God. We need to look at ourselves and to ask ourselves, what are we doing in our relationship with God? How are we viewing, how are we living that relationship with him? The Hebrews, they wanted miracles and signs to prove who God is. The Greeks wanted wisdom. But we proclaim Christ crucified. And it's a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those who are the called, or those who are called, Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. The message of God's word is foolishness to those who are perishing, for it is too simple and weak for some people, but God uses it to save his people. And you and I know that we do not like weakness. We don't like to be weak, do we? We want to be seen as strong. We tend to think of people who are weak as being inferior, as not being up to the mark. And that's because most of us have been taught to face challenges and to confront the difficulties in our lives through our own power and through our own strength, through our own achievement, through our own acquiring it on our own. So many of us as people seek to get through life by attaining as much power and riches as we can. We compete and argue and want to be desirous or to be desired so that we are liked and respected, so that we are able to get what we want, so that we can have our own way. We do not want to be seen as weak or humble or even kind. That's not the world's definition or way of being in control of our destiny in our lives. And yet God welcomes weakness and he blesses it. And we see that in today's gospel reading. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are those who weep and mourn. Blessed are those who are the meek. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. Blessed are those who are the peacemakers, the merciful. Those are who Jesus reveals. And we often tend to think that the Beatitudes are the ways in which we will be blessed if we live in this way. But how many of us desire to live like the Beatitudes? How many of us live the Beatitudes as a response to God's blessing us? But the Beatitudes are not so much about what we do, and they're not so much about our actions, but they're about how we do. They're about our being. They're less about actions and more about relationships. Relationships of love with God and with each other. The Beatitudes are meant to teach us to trust and depend on God more than the circumstances in which we find ourselves. We need to rely on God rather than thinking we can rely on ourselves. But in the world in which we live, as it has been in past centuries, dependence on God and not on ourselves sound a lot like weakness and foolishness. But to those who are being saved, those who are Christ's followers, it is the power of God. And God chose what is foolish to shame the wise and what is weak to shame the strong. Have you ever realized that when we are weak and vulnerable, we begin to see things in a different light? Have you ever realized that? When we are weak and vulnerable, we begin to see things in a different light. And regardless of what form that weakness or vulnerability takes, it opens us up to a new and another way of seeing and hearing things, a new and fresh way of living our lives. We begin to understand who we are as individuals and who we are not, and what really matters in life. Persons who have had a serious or life-threatening or devastating illness or some circumstance in their lives will tell you that it caused them to look at life differently. It changed the way they understand things, the way they and relate to people. For we become more compassionate and humble, we are softened in the way we feel and deal with other people. We are drawn more to live in a life that resembles Jesus' life. For he himself exemplified humility and weakness when he walked this earth in the way he lived and in the way he died. For he lived among the poor and the weak and the outcast and the uneducated and the simple and the marginalized. Not because he liked them better, but because God invites all to become his people. And so, my friends, God was announcing a new way of being in community with him and with one another. And Jesus and St. Paul remind us that those who despise justice and kindness and mercy and humility and God's salvation for us, they laugh at the cross as being weak, as weakness, because for them it is foolishness, it is moronic. For being kind and merciful and humble and fair and just are attributes that are seen as foreign in our world, attitudes that people no longer strive to be. But they are as a result of God's grace and not something we do in order to earn them. There are those who think that a powerful Messiah cannot and should not and would not surrender to such weakness as death on the cross. And they find the cross as disgraceful and shameful, and they turn their backs on him who loves them. But St. Paul said it as strongly as Micah in the first reading, that God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom. So no matter how wise we think we are, the foolishness of God is even better than that. And God's weakness is stronger than human strength, no matter how strong we think we are. The weakness of God is stronger than that. And if people can save themselves through their own knowledge or intelligence or capabilities, then the kingdom of God will be filled with people who are so proud of their achievements, they will not think there were any reason for God. They will think that they were just as good as God. So So God has and continues to call those who are seen as non-entities in this world, those who are willing to admit their need of Him, those who are willing to accept the gift of salvation, to shame the wise and the proud, who will eventually realize that their own strength, no matter how good it is still not good enough. So my friends, our wisdom cannot bring about our salvation. Only God's wisdom can. And no matter how foolish it may appear. So if Jesus is our way, then our way is weakness. Because that's God's way.